grab.
Aboard Beaupre, hung up behind, hit hard by Berube. There'll be a penalty coming up, and then Beaupre swinging his elbow back into Berube, and a crowd gathers again behind the Capitals' goal as Beaupre was out handling, and so that made him fair game in Berube's sights, and down to the ice he went. Looks like Dale Kushner will swing.
Yeah, he's got Mike Lawler. And the Flyers now, obviously, are showing everybody that they feel the Washington Capitals declared open season. So if it's open season, it's open season, boys. And that's why John Beaupre was really reefed by Berube. I think he missed most of them, but he sure went after them. Can't see who's got Berube.
I doubt that I afraid he would want much of him after last time, but you never can tell. Kiprios and Berube are apparently the two who are in the tangle there that you can't see.
Terry Murray was talking to Paul Holmgren. Now Paul Holmgren is up against the glass. I'm sure Terry Murray was saying, okay, you got your way. Now you're letting this thing get out of hand. Kiprios and Kushner now. I hope you packed a lunch for this one. Oh man, what a scrap now between Kiprios and Kushner. Kordick is out there with Lottl. Kushner was wrestling with Lawler, you know, while Kiprios was just lying on top of Berube, so Kushner has to be tired.
Well, Barron's the third man in on that.
You bet. About time. Aya Brady. Where's Pete Peter? Here comes Pete. Here comes Pete.
Boy, he's
Beaupre.
Building up steam, too.
Watch Beaupre get reefed from behind here when Pete gets there. You're talking about one strong goaltender when you talk about Pete Peters, too. He's got Beaupre in a hammer lock. Keith Acton's doing his best to keep Dave Tippett out of it.
Don Koharski will make some notes.
Open season was declared by Dale Hunter when he went after Gord Murphy with his elbow. And the Flyers, oh, here we go. Barron and I are Brady now. You want some? Let's go. Barron's at a disadvantage here. I'm afraid he doesn't have anything to grab onto except his shoulder pads. Murray Barron is a tank, so is I'm afraid he, but neither fights very often. Let's see what they do. I'm afraid he's already cut. Not enough linesmen to go around now, boys. You guys are on your own. Oh, yeah, now Barron's got something to hang on to. He's got I'm afraid he's neck. Not a bad move by Barron. Get in close. Now he's at least got his underwear that he can grab onto. But if it tears away, he'll be at a disadvantage.
They depart. Is that some of his own claret there, or was that from someone else? Kiprios has someone in.
Collision at center ice with a Wings player went down. Sloan getting up. Penny gets Pettit. Heading for the bench, and they'll fight. Sutter and Pettit. And now everyone gets into it, and a Blues player gets punched in the face. Now Lowry wants to go after Kosher. I believe Jeff Brown got a cheap shot from Joey Kosher, and we've got quite a melee across the way now. A 9-3 game, the Blues leading it. Now Gallant trying to wrestle Sutter out of the pile. I'm not sure, John, which Detroit player collided with Sutter at center ice. I believe they were going to their respective benches, but no question, Sutter took a shot at Brent Fettig, and then Brown seemed to get punched and drilled down by Kosher, and that's why all of this is occurring.
Well, I think it was Fettig who upset Sutter, and then Kosher suckered a Blues player, Brown, from behind. Why he did that, I don't know. Jeff Brown did not do anything. And now Izabard and Sutter having words, but meanwhile, Kosher and Lowry trying to be separated. I have to admire Dave Lowry for going after Kosher, who took a blatant cheap shot at Dave or Jeff Brown, and Lowry went right after Kosher. Now Gallant and Sutter push and shove. Now Bassan, here we go again. Bassan gets things started again.
And Gallant gave Bassan quite a shot from behind, and they're going at it. They're paired up now. Every man for himself. This takes you back to the old days. You don't see this very often, John, anymore.
Fortunately. Well, there's a big pile up at center. And if you can make heads or tails about who's on top or who's on the bottom, you're a better man than me. I'll tell you, that looks like a rugby scrum out there.
Five pairings, 10 players, the two goalies looking on, gloves and sticks strewn around the ice. Well, these folks in Detroit have watched hockey for a long time, and they go back to the six-team league years ago, and events like this used to occur with some regularity, with the familiarity of teams and players. But it's a novelty, if nothing else, nowadays. Things have calmed down a bit, but you get the idea something may happen at any moment. Iserman is in the middle of it, a rather gentlemanly player. And they're still shoving and bumping and a lot of yapping going on now. And two linesmen trying to keep 10 players separated. No picnic. And you got Bob Bassan and Gerard Gallant, the two main combatants at the moment. Bassan was going after another Detroit player moments ago. Gallant really slammed them from behind. Now they're taking Sutter over to the penalty box, I believe with Kosher. So that leaves eight in the center of the ring.
Well, I don't know why they just don't start sending players to the dressing room and getting them out of the ice area. Because I'll tell you what, Kosher would not hesitate to come out of that box and go after Sutter or another member of the Blues.
I guess these two teams are going to play tomorrow night somewhere, too, huh? At the arena, 7:35. You don't think the Wings are going to take this one lightly, for sure. They're down 9-3.
Well, this has been going on for about 5 minutes. It all began at center ice when I think Kosher knocked Sutter down. I think Kosher's the one who knocked Sutter down. He was upset, and he went after Brent Fedek. Fedek was knocked down. It wasn't Fedek who began the altercation, but Kosher. And then Kosher came from behind and suckered Jeff Brown. I don't think we'll see it as we have a replay. And Brown was knocked down by Kosher, and that began the entire melee. As Lowry, and you got to give Lowry full marks, Ken, for going after Joe Kosher. I don't care who it is in the National Hockey League, if they sucker one of your players.
Looks for Hillen, so does Adams. Adams finds him. And Brady slides it back into the Pittsburgh zone, but here we go, Adams and Haley. So Haley certainly made his presence noticed with a roughing penalty, and now he is pounding away at Craig Adams. Overhand rights, undercuts, and Haley flattens Craig Adams.
Well, that was a one-sided fight, and he's not the biggest guy on the ice, but boy, does he throw him hard, and can he ever throw him? As he lands a couple real solid, and you're right how he was going over the top underneath. Well, he knows what he's doing, that's for sure. Islanders have scored a first period goal and lead 1-0. Watch this hit on Hillen by Adams. Not particularly a real bad hit, but the Islanders have said they're not going to let anybody take advantage of the small guys, so Haley and Adams get at it. And boy, can this kid Haley ever throw these punches. Watch him as he finally shakes loose, and boy, gets his anger going. And watch these punches over the top, underneath. That's not his first fight, Howie. Taranto gets his stick down and deflects it. Nice power play goal by the Islanders. And here's another fight.
Well, this is Goddard now trying to fire up his team against a guy who's only too willing to accommodate. And when we get another look at it, who knows? He just may have initiated it, even with his team up 3-0. And that's Trevor Gillies. But, you know, when they're on the ice at the same time, this became inevitable.
Well, Trevor says he likes his team to play physical all the time, not just once in a while. Every game he tries to encourage him to get in.
Gillies got a left hand.
Yeah, he did. He staggered Goddard just a little bit.
Ryan's been letting him go. Gillies removes Goddard's helmet. Goddard finally gets a right hand loose for an uppercut.
This is a question of stamina right now. They both acknowledge that they've had enough. Good clean break. But you're right, Howie. Both guys are willing combatants. And Goddard certainly trying to stir up his team, get them into the hockey game, because the Islanders have just totally dominated them. We're going to watch the replay. Goddard, yeah, he wants to go with Gillies. Look at him. He's patting him on the shoulder. That was clearly started by Goddard. You had it right, Howie, trying to stir up his team. And they talk about to each other, going, yep, okay, that was good. That's enough. Yeah.
See you later.
I'm tired. That kind of scenario, that's the one advantage, Howie. It's not always an advantage to have that youth. Here we go again.
Martin just went right after Talbot. That would no doubt be direct retaliation for the Como hit of a week ago. And when players talk about waiting for the right time, when you're up 6-0 in the second period, Martin figured that was the right time, but there's more. Dupuis and Josh Bailey. And you know, all of this was predictable. I think that's why there are more people in the stands tonight. Hamonic now and Michael Rupp. And there was a build-up to this game for the last couple of days that hasn't let anyone among the Islander fans here in this building down. You knew the Islanders were going to be looking to get Talbot.
Well, yeah, that was that. Again, you talked about it, Howie, and taking care of your own. And they were upset last time they met with Talbot, you know, with a cheap shot on Como. So you're right. If there's going to be a time to get someone, this was the time. And Bailey and Dupuis have been going at it. A tremendous tussle. But this is old-time hockey, Howie. And look at the fans. You think the fans, look at it. They're cheering. They're on their feet. And they're loving the Islanders. As you can hear them in the background.
Well, you know what's good, too, is that most of these scraps, whether they've been fights or incidents, have basically been in context of the game. They've come from the flow. Obviously, the one with Goddard and Gillies was Goddard's attempt to wake his team up when he was 3-0.
Right.
But there really haven't been appointment fights or staged fights in this game as much as they resulted from the flow and the passion and the physical aspect of it that's been in evidence from the opening faceoff.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right that this comes out of emotion. And what's happened in the last couple of times, watch Talbot gives Koskinen a little tap. But this was pure from the last game. Look at Martin, and he's just not even, he just suckers him. I don't know how good a shot he got on him, but that's the emotion that transpired from game to game to game. And we talked about it before the game, Howie, that this was going to be a very physical game. And I talked to a few of the players, and they were on high alert, Howie. They were ready for this game. They expected it to be physical. I don't know that they expected to be up 6-0, but they were ready to go. They were ready to do battle. And it's been one heck of a hockey game with everything that you could imagine. And boy, they went at it. I mean, look at this. You don't see this very well. Normally, you wouldn't see it very often. You saw it in Boston and Montreal. Great rivalry. And these guys have been building up over the last three games. And like you said, Howie, that's spontaneity right there. That's not a planned fight.
Bailey shoulders Talbot. They have some words. And then Tangrady and Gillies. And Tangrady turtles.
Now, Tangrady's hurt. You can see him. He's bent over.
It's my error that he was hurt on the hit. He didn't look like it at first. It took him an extra second or two to crumble.
Look at Haley's got Talbot. And they were kind of eyeing each other up. And
I was watching them because they were on one side of the ice as that other hit was being initiated. And they were jawing. After Talbot and Haley came together, they had some words as though they wanted to go, thought better of it temporarily. Talbot down on his back.
Haley got in a pretty good shot. Haley's upset, and they're going to push him off the ice right away. Oh, look at this. Look at this. Haley's going after the goalie. Oh, he wants him. Look, they're not going to let him get to him.
Now it's way out of control, and Johnson's in his second fight in a week. And Haley is trying to do to him what Johnson did to Rick DiPietro. I think Talbot's in there also.
Okay, they're motioning at the benches because they're worried because it's an un... But if you look, as Tangredi's down here. He got hurt on that deal with Gillies.
Yeah, my apologies to Tangredi for thinking he had turtled. Gillies is still yelling at him from the runway.
Yeah, I'm not sure what happened because I think Tangredi was going to get the original penalty. But, boy, this is crazy now. As you're right, Haley came all the way down, and he was looking for Johnson.
Eric Goddard, I believe, came off the bench to get into it.
Haley's going to become a fan favorite in one big hurry.
Oh, he's
look
there.
Look at Orpik. He's looking for him. And listen to these fans. They are going bananas. Well, Howie, if they didn't deliver the message earlier, we thought this might be a very quiet third period. Watch it. There's Gillies. He comes up and hits him high. Tangredi takes it off the glass. His head bounces off the glass, and then everything breaks out. And there's Haley. And you got, there's the right there that lands on Talbot. And Haley, as you said, has been in a couple of fights. Talbot's, he's had enough right there. Now he's going to get up, and he's looking right away. He's looking at Johnson.
Johnson was apparently out around there the whole time.
Look at. But Johnson say, okay, come on, you want to go? And you watch, Goddard's going to come right off the bench. And he just grabs on, and now it's a two-on-one. That's supposed to happen when you have the puck. Not when there's a fight going on, Howie. And now we previewed the game and said it was going to be physical, it was going to be tough.
Well, the alert was on. This, you know, let's face it. After the Johnson DiPietro fight last week, you could see it. The Penguins were pretty much laughing at the Islanders on the Pittsburgh bench. And, you know, that caught the attention of the Islanders and was going to be part of the buildup to tonight's game. And if any of this was predictable, I think it's gone even beyond what we thought it might have become. Because a lot of times when you expect something like this and you get it, it basically happens in the first period and then things settle down. But this has been going on all night.
Well, this has been brewing, and we talked a little bit about it earlier on, Howie, that, you know, it's not just the game against Pittsburgh. It's a lack of respect that the players on the New York Islander team feels like they haven't been getting. You know, calling them up, doormats and running at them. Pittsburgh's been running at them. Toronto the other day was running at them. Ottawa's been running at them. So this just all came to a head. As you can see, that Gillies is upset, but he knows he takes a run at Tangredi. But this all overflowed today just because it happened to be the right opponent at the right time. And they were ready. They had this game on their mind. They had it in the dressing room. I said before, there was a buzz in the dressing room, and they were on high alert.
Dan O'Halloran, the referee, got hit again. So did Nielsen. Nielsen shaken up out by the hash marks. Puck loose in front of the net. Nielsen trying to stay on. Now he's doubled over. As he heads towards the bench, looks back to referee Dan O'Halloran. And oh, by the way, here we go again. Oposo and Stahl were chatting. Letang, Konopka wants in. He and Talbot are going. But Martin of Pittsburgh is trying to hold off Konopka, who keeps throwing right hands at Talbot. And there will be even more penalty minutes on what's been a record night of penalty minutes in Islander history.
Well, there's no doubt that the Islanders have made it quite obvious for me that Mr. Talbot was on their hit list tonight, because they've gone on after him early and they've gone after him a number of times. And And he's hung in there. It's been a tough night for Maxime Talbot. But the message is clear. They did not like the hit on Como. Islanders lead the Penguins 8-3. Watch in the middle of your screen as you're going to see Jack Hillen cross-check Kennedy, who in turn cross-checks Nielsen. And it wasn't long before it all starts again as Koskinen makes a nice save. There's a bit of a slash by Letang, and Oposo and Letang get at it a little bit. And then you're going to see Konopka's going to get in on the play, and they're just still looking for Talbot. Martin trying to help out Talbot, but Konopka's not going to be denied. He's going to get his lick at Talbot, as everybody else in this team seems to want a part of him today.
You know, Butch, there's always the question in a game like this, particularly when you're taking up a cause, as the Islanders certainly appear to be doing, about what kind of carryover. When the crowd chanting, Haley, Haley, just in case he couldn't hear it from the Islander room, and more. And this time it's McDonald for the Islanders and Vitali for Pittsburgh.
Now Vitali wanted McDonald, there's no question about that. Vitali was cross-checking McDonald six or seven times in front of the net, and he wanted McDonald, he wanted his lick.
The way it looks, Butch, anybody finishes this game without any penalty minutes has to buy dinner for the whole team tomorrow night.
Watch the front of the net. You're going to see Vitali. Look at, he's just trying to just get involved. Good. Look at it.
Down low to the corner. Rob Ray goes in to get it. Grabs on to Kaplan. Back to the point. Potter shot. Hits for Metz. Swings and spins it wide. Now in front of the net. Rob Ray and Brian Brashear. And finally they dropped him. The penalty call was on the way in the first place. As Ray comes in, lands a couple, took a couple in the first place. And now Brashear trying to yank his jersey off. Ray trying to get a hand free, falls, gets back up. And now Ray trying to come over the top of the right hand of his own. And I think Ray had been cut earlier in this fight, as he took one really early. I think that was a helmet cut. If you look at where that cut is.
Look out here. And Simpson just went in after Brashear. Now he's pounding away. Anybody can get a hold of. Here goes Patty Lalime.
Esch comes in, so Lalime comes down ice.
They're going to go.
Well, Esch won't take the mask off. Lalime does it for him. Lalime gets the sweater over top of the head of Esch, but he falls down. Now Esch tries to get another hand over the top.
This might be what the Senators needed. Now we got another one going in the corner. Looks like Sean Van Allen.
Radivojevic.
Yep. They're going. Are they ever going?
Well, Radivojevic is absorbing more than he's... I don't think he's thrown one yet. And I think Radivojevic has been cut.
The goalie's still at it.
And Allen falls, and that gives Radivojevic a chance. And now gradually getting players off the ice.
And Simpson's still cruising around. Here, look out here. Old time hockey's back in Philadelphia. And you think the crowd loves it? I think so. Started from the faceoff, Rob Ray out against Donald Brashear. You got the feeling something was going to happen. They follow each other all the way to the net. Ray's looking for anybody at this point. And he finds somebody. And away they go. And Brashear is one big man. And he shows it there. And then after that, Simpson jumped in. That started some more work, and then the goalies went at it. Listen to the crowd now. And here's a guy that wishes like heck he could have been in this, because Burke is one of the tougher goalies in the league. He loves it.
Well, Aleem and Ash have both been ejected, so Prusak and Burke will have to come out and finish this game.
And there go the goalies. They had some fun. And Patrick Aleem did a little better than his last fight. Who was that again, Dean?
Felix Potvin.
Felix Potvin, who's one of the tougher goalies in the league. Not much was thrown here in either one of them. Oh, yeah, the fans don't like this stuff, huh? Jeez, I love when people say that. They're all up on their feet and into it.
Well, we talked about the opening, Greg, about the fact that if this game got out of hand one way or the other, it might get out of hand, and it's out of hand.
And Marty Hadlett's nowhere in sight. Nothing to do with it.
Hadlett had nothing to do with it. Yeah, you're right. Well, we'll see now who gets what. And to be frank with you, to get the whole rundown, we may have to bring up the PA microphone just to get the rundown of who's going to get what out of this. We're not going to ask Scotty Too Hotty to have to try and jot all this stuff down.
I can't believe the reaction in this building. I cannot believe how fired up they are. Bring back the get rid of it and let's have the instigator and get rid of that baby.
Well, you know what, Greg, on many levels, I was talking with the Philadelphia broadcasters before the game. There has been a huge amount of pressure in this marketplace on the Philadelphia Flyers, which is bizarre when you consider where they are in the standings. But the pressure has been on the fact that this Philadelphia team has been tabbed as a club that can't beat the other real contenders. They have lost to Ottawa. They have lost to Tampa. They have lost to New Jersey. They have lost to Toronto. And there's great pressure on this team to beat other truly contending teams. And also, clearly, after what happened in the last game between these two teams, there was some talk that this team didn't stand up for itself against Ottawa.
And he's not smiling at the moment, but I know down deep he is. There's Bobby Clark, who was involved in quite a few of these babies in his day.
Oh, yeah.
He never changed his expression much in the press box, but maybe there's a flashback or two there.
So the Flyers will win this game. Their team gets into an all-man-in brawl. Rob Ray gets cut. And the Flyers score 5 goals, which means everybody here in the building with a ticket will get a free chicken sandwich from Chick-fil-A. So the Flyer fans are loving this night.
And you have to think at this point that this was probably a good thing for the Ottawa Senators. They need something to rally around to get themselves going. They've been in a bit of a funk the last couple of games, and that's an understatement. Maybe this will create some bonding and some team energy to carry them through this next stage.
So a minute 45 left, and we'll see what, if anything, happens. And here's Neal right in front, and here we go again. And oh, Neal drops and then pounds Somek into the ice. Oh, that is nasty.
Now Chera's going, and he's just raining some. Oh, look out. Chera's got a hold of somebody. This isn't pretty either.
Oh, he's got Matty Tomander, and I don't like Tomander's chances here. He better just cover up here because he is going to get tagged bad. And Tomander is looking for help. He's wrestling Chera nicely to just keep himself out of the gunshot, and now the ref comes in. Well, after everything, it's 4-on-4, and right off the draw now it's going to be Fisher and everybody in again. Fisher and Hanzus. Hanzus much larger, but I like Fisher's chances here. Oh, and he drops Hanzus with a hammer. Hanzus gets back up. Fisher throws him down again. Oh, Hanzus is not doing well here.
Hitchcock talked to Hanzus and John LeClair. LeClair shook his head going away from the bench. These two started it here when the puck dropped. Isn't that interesting?
Now a minute 39 remaining. in regulation time. I'm not anticipating overtime. I'm not sure either team's ever going to get close enough to the other team's goaltender. They can't seem to get out of the faceoff circle.
Watch this. This was before this all happened. Recchi goes over to talk to Hitchcock. Now that isn't it. Now he'll say, come on over, boys. I want to talk to the rest of them. But before that, before the faceoff, we had it on air. Hitchcock talked to LeClaire, and he talked to Hanzus. And then LeClaire jumped over the boards and shook his head. And now the official's going over to Hitchcock at the moment.
Lots of room on both benches for the last 99 seconds, and now Dan Marowelli speaking with both head coaches. So we'll try and get this face-off done again. This time it's Recchi and Smolinski. Off the draw, Recchi wins it. Puck floats back to the corner, and here's Kapanen back to get it. Recchi back up ice. Fires through the middle. Here's LeClaire to the line. Sends it in. Redden goes to chase it. Here's Redden along the boards. Clears the puck ahead. Recchi comes across, and now we're going to get one going here. Redden and LeClaire, and in front Smolinski and Recchi. Smolinski comes back with a couple of rates over the top, falls, gets back up. Recchi keeps going.
That's a pretty good one going at center ice.
Well, still a minute 15 to go in the third. The question will be, will either team have enough guys to finish the game?
And now Recchi points at the Ottawa Senator bench, at Jacques Martin. So things continue to heat up.
Well, I can't wait to hear the post-game media conference.
And Hitch is going to say, let's keep it going here. The Senators are down to five players on the bench at the moment. And what next?
Well, ironically enough, the spark plug for a lot of this came in the last game between the two, and the guy who is our spark plug is still in the penalty box.
Here it was beforehand. There's LeClaire, and there's Hanzus. Now, I don't know what he's saying, but watch LeClaire's reaction.
Like, oh, you want
and
me
those,
to what, coach?
And those two went right out, started the next fight at the faceoff. So, you know, you be the judge on that one. Not that both sides aren't guilty, but I think if you were in the court of law on that one, you'd say Hitchcock guilty on that particular play, but who am I to say what he was actually saying to the players? Now what? And these refs are going to go over another chat. Hey, boys, it didn't work last time, but you can try again.
I'm serious. There may not end up being enough guys left to finish the game. They still got a minute 15 to go.
The refs are begging right now. Please, guys. And let's... Well, we got Lapointe going on. He's not afraid to duke it out. And who else? And Craig Hertzberg's on the bench, and he was the guy that was absolutely ballistic at Jacques Martin running down the bench before. Now we got Janssen out there. We got Jason Spetz out there.
I believe out of all this, Ottawa will get what amounts to an inconsequential power play, but what they do get is the odd man advantage in the event of another fight.
I don't think anything's going to happen this time with Sammy Kapanen on the ice. Oh, yes. Oh.
Spezza now going at his man. Oh, those two drop it as Spezza comes in, and he goes down as he got tangled up right after the faceoff with Patrick Sharp.
I told you, refs, it wouldn't work.
It's almost like now you don't want to be the guy who doesn't get kicked out of the game.
Well, now the Ottawa Senators are down to three on the bench, three on the ice. The Flyers down to four on the bench. I don't think, I've been in this business a long time, I don't think I've ever seen this. Not like this.
Well, that whole thing took 2 seconds, so now we're down to a minute 13.
You know what Mark Crawford did tonight before the game? Put up a big sign on the board in the room that said, our goal tonight is to score on the guy who's wearing the red wing on his sweater. So they want to score on the other net tonight, not their own.
Run over. Look out, Holmstrom touches Roy. It's only going to take one thing, and this thing's going to ignite. Holmstrom hits Roy, and Roy hits, look out. Here comes Patrick after the referee, and he's going to get the penalty, and here they come.
Patrick just got another two. He's got four.
Holmstrom did his job. He got him antagonized. And the boys congregate very quickly. And 20,000 are on their feet in the building, let alone the living room at home watching here on UPN 50.
And Danino had his shot tipped wide. Lafave cleared it out to center. Some more heavy hitting. Rouse stepped into his man. Then Danino does likewise. LaRue's there. Up by Drake. Look at the size mismatch.
Oh, here we go. Draper and LaRue. There's McCarty right there. Here comes another car. Rogers. There we go. Rogers. And they're going to, linesman's going to break it up and spoil the fun for everybody right out of the gate.
What do you get for that?
What are you going to give for, Greg? Holy mackerel. Come on, the fun's just starting, gang. Rogers doesn't mind. McCarty's going to give some service. And now Big LaRue pushes Rouse. He's looking to go. Guaranteed on that, boy. They're only starting.
I don't think they'd give him 5 minutes for that, but Rogers did have 24 fighting penalties.
Well, he's fighting a willing, he's a willing guy, that guy.
Rigolatio.
Then it's a goal! There it is, our first goal of the game. Fedorov in front, and it's 1-0 Red Wings with 12:54 to play.
Brendan Shanahan was right at the top of the crease.
That's good, good stop to knock it away. Had that stick down before Kaminsky could deflect it home. Perfect. Little soft pass to McCarty. Is Rick YP to an open wing.
Ozolin,
look out. Gave it away. Here's Fedorov away to the races. Fedorov shoots goal!
Sergei Fedorov give him two, and it's 2-0 Red Wings.
None since coming back. The work ethic has been there, and that's what the players will look to. You know, when you work that hard and you get that kind of ability, sooner or later the goals and the points are going to come.
Well, Fedorov from Yzerman and Lidstrom as they mix it up. Everybody into it. And Fedorov unassisted.
Corbett's got the gloves off already, and he's going after somebody. Kozlov trying to grab him, can't do it. And Rouse there. And now they got Rogers again down there. Been looking for it all night. Lafave, Fitzgerald, Miller. As long as everybody's paired up, it's not two on one. That is Rogers. Top of your screen up there. Linesman's got a hold of him. He's the guy that really wants after somebody. Look at Bob Rouse with it right there. With a big bear hug on somebody. Look at LaPointe. Throw somebody down.
Aaron
right.
Miller.
See, there's the third guy with that arm in. That's what Ward's got to do. Keep him out of there. Aaron Miller is the man LaPointe dropped. Who's Ward with? I can't see the number. Now LaFave will be the extra man there. There's an odd man. They got to get in over there. They got three on two down there. Here comes Patrick Roy.
Oh, where's Ozzie?
Got to come over there.
Where's
now.
Ozzie?
And Kozlov doesn't realize there's three on two. Roy wants to get at Osgood. And Ozzie's standing at center ice. And the referee won't let him go. Look at Patrick Roy. Come on, let's go. Come on, let's go. He's challenging Osgood. Off comes the headgear.
Here we go.
Once again, we go again. Osgood and Roy. It was Vernon and Roy a year ago. And Roy popped Vernon pretty good. And Mike Vernon came back and cut Patrick Roy. And a much smaller Osgood standing up with the exchange. right at center ice. Wow. This isn't March 26th. It's April Fool's, and no fooling around tonight. Juan, it's an exhibition, and the crowd loves it when Osgood gets the upper hand for a short second on Juan. All that goalie equipment. Now he's got him down.
Oh, baby.
This is what they came for. It took 53 minutes to happen, but it happened. And they are out of their seats.
They're chanting Ozzy Ozzy.
Listen to them.
You don't see anybody sitting down, do you?
Oh, baby. Well, Patrick Waugh challenged. He made the challenge. Terry Gregson tried to stop it. He couldn't. And finally, Osgood said, okay, I'll accommodate you. And it ain't maybe done yet. Miller and LaPointe, they're down at the far blue line looking to pop each other.
And this will be the second fight in Terry Gregson's fight.
They're both for six in the power play.
I guess as great, Kenny, as this Red Wing team has been for the last 3, 4, 5 years, and exciting to watch. What happened here tonight is kind of amongst all the greatness out of people like Eisenman and
fight,
and it is Shanahan this time. But see, as soon as the puck was dropped, they went at it, and they're gonna
Deadmarsh
with the left going. Shanahan's gotta get mad and get up and get going. As Deadmarsh got three or four left in, and Shanahan's just trying to gain his balance there. Deadmarsh got his right arm tied up. Deadmarsh a lefty, Shanahan a righty, and they get it away from the play so they don't get suspended.
Deadmarsh's a tough customer.
Yeah, he is. And that was all over the late shot. I didn't see it start, so I don't know whether Shanahan was prepared for it or not.
Two good Canadian boys, even though Deadmarsh was on the U.S. Olympic team, hold dual citizenship. His mom's American, his dad's Canadian. Played for the U.S. side against Brendan Shanahan.
To the left of Bouchard.
Look at this. They got both clubs coming on the ice. Look
this
out.
This is bad.
Look out.
At the siren. Everybody is on the ice.
Look out. Nyland is after somebody in back of the pack, and away they go. Spare goaltenders. Everybody's on there now, and the melee starts. Sevigny right in the middle of it with Malarchuk, and there is a pileup down there that is dangerous because somebody could get hurt.
Now, you notice referee Bouchard. He will not get hurt.
Look out. Look at this. Sevigny and Malarchuk, Bob, are going at it. The two spare goalies down in the corner.
Bruce Hood is standing back there, you notice. And he is assessing the situation because he's going to have to hand out a heck of a pile of penalties when this is all settled away. I'll tell you.
No, interestingly enough, Dale Hunter and Anton Stastny, look at this. This is Peter Stastny and Marion Tremblay. Now fights are breaking out everywhere. Dale Hunter, Anton Stastny are on the Quebec bench. And if they leave that bench, they could be suspended. So they're being held there by the trainer. And now I don't know who's all fighting with who, but there's about four of them down in the front. Tremblay and Peter Stastny. Nyland and Moeller. And boy, are they going at it. Hodges turning the them apart.
There are 14 different fights going on at this one time. The 14 pairings.
Boy, Randy Moeller, Bob, it looks like from up here is cut wide open. It's underneath the top of that helmet. It looks like some blood on him. He's tied up with Nyland. And Hodges is just going to say, all right, you guys, you want to go? Go. There's no way you can stop him. Malarchuk and Sevigny are still going at each other down along the board. That's Moeller and Nyland you're looking at. Look out. Moeller, I can't tell, but he looks like he's been cut in the forehead. And he really wants Nyland badly, I'll tell you what. can't tell if Moeller's cut Bob down there. Number 21 is, he's got red on by that helmet. And I don't know if he's been cut or what. Yes, he has. Boy, his face is full of blood down there. And there is Montreal trainer Gaetan Lefebvre looking at John Hamel. He is down and looks like he's out of it.
Moeller is cut over the eyes at the bench. And he is receiving some attention from the trainers for the Quebec Nordiques. And they now appear to be in a let's talk it over mood and get back to the rooms and resume a hockey series that up to this point has been so emotional, yes, but it has been great for the hockey fan. I'm sure the hockey fan does not relish what they see here now on the Forum ice.
Well, you see a lot of kneeling around after the end of periods, but seldom do you see this kind of a breakout, but I guess you could almost see this coming. There's where Hamel and Slager are tied up. D'Amico is between them, and Mario Tremblay's in there, and oh, boy, did Slager caught John Hamel with a left hand, and Hamel obviously not expecting to get hit, thinking that he was tied up as well as Hamel was by the linesman, and he just decked him, and I wouldn't be surprised if he's out cold. He has not moved yet.
I know they're sitting at home now and they're saying, well, what happened to Jean Hamel? Well, I know commentators are supposed to have sharp eyes and you're supposed to be able to relate exactly what has happened. But so many pairings. I think I counted 14, Mickey, at one time. And I honestly didn't see how Hamel got injured to the extent that he appears to be.
Well, you know what happens in a case like that is a fella thinks that the fight is over. He loosens up his grip on the other player, thinks that the linesman's got him tied up as well. And then the other guy, realizing that he wants to get that last punch in, really fires it, and the other guy not expecting it, of course.
Numéro 33, Richard Sévigny, 5 minutes pour s'être battu. Oh, numéro 21.
Look out, they're going to go again, my goodness.
This is bad blood.
It's Hunter. I'll tell you what, they're after Louis Slager, Bob.
Oh, here she goes again.
Wally Weir, McPhee, and they're going to team up, and they're after everybody. They're after Slager. Boy, oh boy, oh boy, and here goes Dale Hunter and Sévigny are at it over there on the far side. Don't tell me we've got to go through this again. We haven't even started to play in the third period. Still 20 minutes on the clock. And it started out, Bob, as we expected.
Jacques Lemaire just made a heck of a move over there. He grabbed Carboneau by the sweater and pulled him toward the bench. Jacques Lemaire standing over there on the Canadiens bench. Trying to get some sense into this situation here, the sixth game of the series.
They went after Louis Slager. They're still announcing. Now here goes again. Mark Hunter trying to get at. Bruce Hood is just having a tough time, boy, I'll tell you.
Mark Hunter swings his stick at Slager.
He's trying to get at Slager.
Sévigny is punching Dale Hunter.
They're going at it.
The referee, Bruce Hood, is trying to get them all apart, and I think he is going to send the teams back to the dressing room.
Tell you what.
Here, without getting the third period started at all.
Mark Hunter, I'll tell you what, they better keep an eye on Mark Hunter. Bruce Hood is taking the charge between these two, and Mark Hunter is trying to get at Louis Slager, obviously, for the punch he laid on John Hamel, who has not returned to the ice.
And through all this, the PA announcer continues his duties.
Well, he just got finished, Bob, announcing all the penalties at the end of the second period. Now, look at, here comes Hunter again. He's coming after Louis Slager. Look out. Now, Dale Hunter and Mark, look at, Mark grabbed Dale, look out. Keep. Here they go.
This is a brawl to end all brawls.
Dale and Mark Hunter, Bob, were almost at it, two brothers. Now, they're right over by that. Look at, Michel Bergeron trying to keep Hunter and Slager apart.
Now, I want to point out that Michel Goulet has got a headlock on Slager, and they now got him off the ice and into the dressing room.
Yeah.
tell you what, this is incredible.
Mark Hunter comes diving in on top of two players who are on the ice.
You know, they got Larry Robinson's been involved now. Actually, you know, this, I don't know if it's going to be any good for anybody, but it certainly cannot help the cause of the Montreal Canadiens. They're down to at least maybe three, maybe four if they're lucky. We don't know yet if Ludwig has been thrown out of the game or what he got right at the end of the period, but
Mario Tremblay has been...
Mark and Dale.
Mario Tremblay is being escorted by the referee Bruce Hood to the far side. I think he's gone.
It was Mark and Dale Hunter that were at it down there. Mark jumped on top. Finally got Bob. They got Tremblay. You're right over to the bench. Nyland is... He's come out of the dressing room, if you can believe that, standing over by the Montreal bench.
Number 30, Clint Marlichuk. 5 minutes for fighting. Number 32, Dale Hunter. A double minor for roughing. Number 21, Randy Muller. 5 minutes fighting, 10 misconduct. Number 26, Peter Stastny. 5 minutes fighting, and again misconduct. Number 12, Louis Slager. 5 minutes for fighting, and again misconduct. To the Canadiens, number 33, Richard Sivigny. 5 minutes for fighting. Number 21, Guy Carbonneau. 2 minutes for roughing. Number 30, Chris Nyland. 5 for fighting, another 5 for fighting, 10 misconduct, and again misconduct. Number 14, Mario Tremblay, 5 for fighting, and again misconduct. Number 28, Jean Hamel, 2 minutes for roughing, the time of the penalty.
Que le mieux et Corson ait eu tiré au but. Alors Gilles, vas-y maintenant, je m'excuse d'avoir été si long.
On voit les deux joueurs du Canadien qui sautent sur la patinoire. On voit déjà Skodar qui s'est approché de Corson. Par la suite, Resch a même lancé son bâton. Il voit plus de bâton et c'est le combat. Skodar a placé les premiers coups. Je ne sais pas si vraiment le mieux s'attendait à un combat de la part. On va voir le jeu. Lemieux n'avait pas sans doute dans l'idée d'entreprendre un combat, lui. Et comme Skodar, Richard l'a mentionné, n'est qu'un réserviste, il n'a même pas participé aux quatre dernières rencontres, eh bien, il a sans doute été envoyé pour le faire.
Et vous n'avez pas vu le pire encore?
C'est ce qui s'est passé au tout début. Par la suite, avec le bruit de foule, les deux équipes se sont présentées sur la patinoire. Patrick Roy était l'un des premiers à venir. Mais comme on voit, semble bien calme au départ. On a des joueurs comme Marsh qui se sont présentés, Samuelson. Il y a eu beaucoup de dialogues entre certains joueurs, mais surveillez bien, tout va suivre par la suite. Dave Brown, l'homme fort des Flyers, va faire son apparition. Cordick, Nyland et compagnie vont le faire.
Là,
voilà,
c'est
Brown que l'on voit, n'était même pas en uniforme, n'était même pas prêt. Son gilet était au vestiaire.
Et là, Gilles, encore à ce moment-là, il y a des joueurs qui essaient de parlementer. Bon, tenez-vous tranquille, retournez à vos vestiaires, mais... Vous avez bien vu, et c'est clair, là, on peut nous accuser de partisanerie, mais c'est Ospodar qui est le responsable de toute cette situation.
Voilà.
Mais Ospodar, est-ce qu'il est vraiment responsable? Qui a décidé d'utiliser cette stratégie d'empêcher les joueurs des Canadiens depuis le début des séries de tirer au but? C'est, sans accuser personne, ça doit venir quand même de plus haut. Alors là, c'est Nyland et Brown qui sont restés accrochés l'un à l'autre pendant un très, très long moment.
Ce sont des vrais combats qui ont duré, je ne sais pas combien de minutes.
De toute façon, Gilles, bon, ces scènes-là, je préfère ne pas les décrire, mais ce qu'on peut conclure de tout ça, c'est que nous et les journalistes qui étions ici au Forum et les spectateurs qui étaient déjà arrivés, je suis certain qu'ils ne sont pas très heureux, ils sont même un peu bouleversés de ce qui s'est passé. Ça nous a laissé un goût très amer, parce que c'est quand même, écoutez, le hockey, Gilles et moi, c'est notre gagne-pain finalement jusqu'à un certain point. Et d'assister à des scènes comme celle-là, il ne faut pas blâmer tous les joueurs, mais il y a des joueurs, certains joueurs des Canadiens n'avaient pas le choix. Il fallait absolument qu'ils se portent à la rescousse de leurs coéquipiers, comme ceux des Flyers d'ailleurs.
Glenn Rice, que l'on voit ici, qui se montre facilitateur, et qui est quand même un joueur qui habituellement n'a jamais mêlé de difficultés sur la patinoire, a été l'un des instigateurs.
Et pourtant, on ne s'était pas servi tellement des bras dans cette série. On avait joué au hockey, nous avions assisté à de très bons matchs. Dans quel état est-ce qu'ils vont être ces joueurs quand ils vont reprendre le match ce soir?
Alors, vous l'avez parlé, le style de jeu que nous avons adopté les Canadiens, ou encore les Flyers de l'Olympique.
Ça, c'est Mark Hall et Chelios, oui.
Qu'est-ce qui va en rester du style de jeu présentement? Plusieurs joueurs se sont épuisés dans ce combat qui a duré je ne sais pas combien de minutes. L'image parle par elle-même ici.
Gilles, on a voulu permettre les accrochages, on a voulu permettre... On a laissé passer toutes sortes d'infractions, et ça fait des années que ça dure. Il fallait s'attendre à ce que ça éclate un de ces soirs, et ça a éclaté pour une raison absolument stupide. Et encore une fois, je répète que l'instigateur de tout ça, ce n'est pas un joueur des Canadiens. C'est un joueur des Flyers de Philadelphie, Ed Ospodar, un joueur marginal, probablement frustré de ne pas avoir joué ou presque pendant les séries éliminatoires.
Alors, on a déjà tenté de vendre le hockey aux États-Unis avec les Flyers de Philadelphie. Pendant qu'on nous montre encore ses seins dans Don Island et Blanche, je vous assure qu'on a eu 3 ou 4 combats de la sorte entre les deux joueurs. On s'est accroché par la suite, on s'est reposé, on croyait que tout était terminé. Et surveillez bien, le combat va reprendre à nouveau. Il y a eu Forson également qui s'en est mêlé. Tuckett, Bordick, la scène la plus disgracieuse qu'ils aient été donné de voir.
Il y en a, Gilles, qui vient de nous dire qu'il n'y a pas de violence dans la Ligue nationale. Ça, c'est le plus bel exemple de cette violence. Et il fallait que ça éclate en finale de conférence, dans un match aussi important que celui de ce soir.
Je parlais, Richard, qu'on voulait vendre le hockey il y a quelques années avec les Flyers et Philadelphie. Eh bien, le réseau SPN, après sondage, s'est aperçu encore une fois cette année que sa cote d'écoute était diminuée. Et ce n'est pas surprenant. On pourrait perdre également des amateurs de hockey au Québec.
Remarquez qu'il y en a malheureusement qui apprécient ce genre de scène. Ça existe dans d'autres sports. Mais d'autres sports, je parle de sport spectacle, oui. Ça aussi, le hockey, c'est un spectacle. Mais apparemment, c'est un spectacle qui est sérieux. Et là, on voit les deux joueurs qui sont épuisés. Il y en a plusieurs, Gilles, qui vont pas commencer le match fatigué. Tu sais ce que c'est, tu as joué longtemps dans la Ligue nationale.
Bon. Je me demande comment les instructeurs vont pouvoir réagir, faire l'évaluation des forces perdues pendant ces combats. On n'a pas d'arbitre encore une fois. Il a fallu quand même attendre je ne sais pas combien de minutes avant de voir les officiels qui n'étaient certainement pas en uniforme, qui n'étaient pas prêts à sauter sur la patinoire. Mais quand même, je crois que leur présence aurait pu se faire sentir près de la clôture.
Gilles, habituellement, on n'insiste pas sur ce genre d'image. Mais là, il ne s'agit plus là, simplement d'une anecdote, il ne s'agit plus d'un fait divers. Il s'agit d'une chose extrêmement importante. Il s'agit d'une nouvelle. Il s'agit de l'avenir de la Ligue nationale de hockey également. Donc, nous n'avons pas le choix, nous vous présentons ces images. Nous le regrettons pour ceux que ça pourrait offenser, mais espérons que ça servira d'exemple à l'avenir et que là, la Ligue nationale de hockey sera absolument obligée de réagir. Parce que là, Gilles, si on ne donne pas de punition plus sévère aux responsables de ces situations-là, eh bien, ça va continuer ad nauseam et ad vitam aeternam. C'est édifiant de voir ça, un bonhomme à moitié nu.
Il ne faudrait surtout pas accuser tous les joueurs, Richard, comme
pas
tu l'as mentionné.
Pas du tout.
Il y a peut-être 5 ou 6 joueurs qui ont été impliqués.
Et il y a plusieurs pacificateurs qui ont essayé de les séparer, dont Gainé, dont Carbonneau, dont Robinson. Enfin, vous les connaissez aussi bien que moi.
Voilà, pendant que tout semblait rétabli, et bien, c'est d'autres
c'est Carson.
Il y a Cordic également.
Et combien ça va coûter en amende tout ça? Très peu, trois aussi. Parce que ça mérite d'être exemplaire. Pour les responsables, il faudra qu'on sache qui sont les vrais responsables. Quand André Van Hellemann et les deux juges de ligne ont finalement fait leur apparition sur la patinoire, ils sont allés consulter certains joueurs, dont Claude Lemieux, qui était à l'origine de tout ça. Quand je dis qu'il était à l'origine de tout ça, c'est qu'il était impliqué à l'origine. Et ils leur ont demandé la version des faits. Alors, qu'est-ce qu'on va donner comme pénalité avant le début du match? Je n'en sais rien. L'arbitre n'était pas là au début. Les deux juges de ligne sont arrivés très en retard. Et justement, Radio-Canada, juste avant ça, on présente une émission d'une demi-heure sur la sécurité au hockey. Ça tombe à pic.
On va sans doute regarder le film à l'intérieur, Richard, avec le vice-président de la Ligue, les officiels et tout. Et comme tu l'as mentionné, il y aura non seulement des pénalités pour ce match, il y aura sans doute des suspensions qui vont suivre.
Ben, à condition, évidemment, qu'on étudie bien ce qui s'est passé, qu'on donne une version juste des faits. Nous avons été des témoins oculaires.
Évidemment, il y a des gens qui ne sont pas nécessairement des partisans des Canadiens qui peuvent nous accuser, nous, d'être de partisanerie. Mais on vous l'a montré. Est-ce que ça n'était pas un geste inoffensif pour Carson est venu après chaque période de sortement et d'aller tirer dans le filet adversaire quand les joueurs avaient quitté la glace? C'est régulier, ça se faisait. Mais on a décidé au cours de cette série de les empêcher de le faire par tous les moyens. Et là, quand on a vu ce soir chez les Flyers qu'on n'avait pas réussi à les empêcher, ben, Hospodar a décidé de s'en mêler, reste au billon là. Mais Espoder a décidé de s'en mêler et de s'en prendre à le mieux. As-tu déjà vu un geste le plus stupide dans ta vie? Et c'est lui qui est responsable de tout ça.
C'est inexplicable, je suis persuadé que ça a été fondé. On avait pensé de le faire, si et ça se produisait.
Ça vient fausser toute cette série, Gilles. Espérons au moins, et c'est fort, et c'est toujours possible, que nous allons assister à un bon match de hockey. Espérons qu'ils ont tout laissé ça là, qu'ils ont tout réglé ça, et pour toujours, parce que là, il faut absolument prendre des mesures draconiennes. Et bien là, c'est au moment, justement, où tout semblait vouloir s'arrêter. Les juges de ligne étaient là, l'arbitre était arrivé. Alors là, on a demandé aux joueurs de se diriger à leurs vestiaires respectifs, ce qu'ils ont éventuellement fait. De toute façon, les principaux protagonistes étaient tellement fatigués qu'ils n'avaient pas d'autre choix.
Sans doute intéressant de suivre encore une fois le déroulement. C'est Andy Van Elleman qui est l'arbitre ce soir. Il est l'un des doyens dans le circuit. Il a toujours été considéré comme le numéro 1.
Il y a certainement des réunions en ce moment. D'ailleurs, il est 8h15 ou presque, et le match n'est pas encore commencé. On est en train de se consulter les arbitres et probablement Brian O'Neill, le vice-président, puisque Ziegler, lui, n'est certainement pas là. Enfin, je n'ose pas m'avancer, là, il est peut-être là. Mais on ne l'a pas vu encore ici, depuis le début des séries. Alors là, les juges de ligne, les juges de ligne et l'arbitre Van Elleman sont revenus sur la patinoire, de sorte qu'on devrait voir les joueurs revenir dans quelques instants. Et espérons maintenant que ce sera du hockey. Parce qu'on aime autant voir Gilles, contrairement à certaines scènes, les joueurs porter leur uniforme plutôt que de se présenter le torse nu sur la patinoire.
Surtout que les Flyers de Philadelphie, Richard, on les avait...
Aboard Beaupre, hung up behind, hit hard by Berube. There'll be a penalty coming up, and then Beaupre swinging his elbow back into Berube, and a crowd gathers again behind the Capitals' goal as Beaupre was out handling, and so that made him fair game in Berube's sights, and down to the ice he went. Looks like Dale Kushner will swing.
Yeah, he's got Mike Lawler, and the Flyers now obviously are showing everybody that they feel the Washington Capitals declared open season. So if it's open season, it's open season, boys, and that's why John Beaupre was really reefed by Berube. I think he missed most of them, but he sure went after them. Can't see who's got Berube.
I doubt that Iafredi would want much of him after last time, but you never can tell. Kiprios and Berube are apparently the two who are in the tangle there that you can't see.
Terry Murray was talking to Paul Holmgren. Now Paul Holmgren is up against the glass. I'm sure Terry Murray was saying, okay, you got your way. Now you're letting this thing get out of hand. Kiprios and Kushner now. I hope you packed a lunch for this one. Oh man, what a scrap now between Kiprios and Kushner. Portick is out there with Lottl. Kushner was wrestling with Lawler, you know, while Kiprios was just lying on top of Berube, so Kushner has to be tired.
Well, Barron's the third man in on that.
You bet. About time. Iafredi. Where's Pete Peter? Here comes Pete.
Boy, he's
Beaupre.
Building up steam, too.
Watch Beaupre get reefed from behind here when Pete gets there. Talking about one strong goaltender, when you talk about Pete Peters, too. He's got Beaupre in a hammerlock. Keith Acton's doing his best to keep Dave Tippett out of it.
Don Koharski will make some notes.
Okay. open season was declared by Dale Hunter when he went after Gordon Murphy with his elbow. And the Flyers, oh, here we go. Barron and Iafredi now. You want some? Let's go. Barron's at a disadvantage here. Iafredi doesn't have anything to grab onto except his shoulder pads. Murray Barron is a tank. So is Iafredi, but neither fights very often. Let's see what they do. Iafredi's already cut. Not enough linesmen to go around now, boys. You guys are on your own. Oh, yeah, now Barron's got something to hang on to. He's got Iafredi's neck. Not a bad move by Barron. Get in close. Now he's at least got his underwear that he can grab onto. But if it tears away, he'll be at a disadvantage.
They depart. Is that some of his own claret there, or was that from someone else? Kiprios has someone in.
One final gasp for the Rangers. Esposito's got it! Save it! And the game will end.
Chavis gives Esposito a pat, and Esposito breaks his stick. He had the game-tying goal, but he couldn't get it by Chavis.
How about that for an ending? Rod Gilbert, what do you think? Wait a minute, hold a second, Rod. We've got some problems going here. John Davidson is down there, right in the thick of things. And Wensink, you missed it because he was not on the play. Wensink had gone into the goal and had both feet up on Davidson's chest. Both blades on Davidson's chest. About a minute and a half of tennis before the end of the game. Davidson threw him down, was furious about it, but had to stay in the net. So apparently J.D. has gone down to complain about that. The puck had gone down the other end of the ice when Wensink got both blades up on Davidson's chest before. And apparently that's what's got him bugged. Let's stay there a second, Bill.
Tim and John Davidson, the same John Davidson, played a hell of a hockey game in the net for the Rangers. Certainly no fault of his that the Rangers lost this hockey game 4-3.
Three out of the four goals went in when they had an extra skater in front of Davidson.
We're going to show you that save that Chivas made on Esposito.
Frank Beaton and Al Secord started to go. Look out, they got sticks too. At somebody in the crowd. O'Reilly's after somebody in the crowd. Oh, this could be bad. Oh, there go the Bruins. Oh, you hate to see this.
The fan grabbed O'Reilly's stick.
But the worst thing the players can do is to go in the crowd like this. There goes McNabb. McNabb's dropped his stick. He's not swinging. To McNabb's credit, they're going to pull that guy apart. Boston team is up in the stands. The Rangers have stayed on the ice.
The fan grabbed Riley's stick. Riley went after the fan and the stick.
Now, if the Bruins don't get down there pretty soon, there's going to be too many fans up there around them. I hope they come back down on the ice.
Esposito had been back in the dressing room. He came back out.
Peacemakers over there now. Most of the uniformed attendants are there trying to form a barricade between the Bruins and the fans. It had started as a discussion between Davidson and Wensink. Secord and Beaton, who had tangled once or twice earlier, began to get into it, and somebody, I can't call him a fan, in the crowd reached over and grabbed a stick. There's Creighton up there trying to be a peacemaker with his team. Freddie making a good move. O'Reilly then went over the glass, and his teammates went up to protect him. He didn't need any protection. But that's the worst thing you can see in a hockey rink, is when the players decide to go over that barricade.
Jim, the fans have no right.
None. I agree with you, Bill.
No
completely.
Right at all to take a player's stick from out of his hand.
I'd like to see him.
Certainly in the height of a hockey game, in the height of a tight hockey game, fans pay admission to see the game, period.
But, Bill, there's just too many people and too big a crowd to have players instigate something like this. It cannot be done.
Absolutely.
Or permitted.
I agree with you.
Now the hit on the play on Brent Severin, and an offside call. Pusher and Severin.
Severin's a tough kid, boy, out of Florida. And Pusher's certainly in it, up to his neck with this guy. And he's a veteran and knows how to fight. But now Severin just holding on. Pusher got a couple of short chops in with that little extra length of the reach. Severin hung on pretty good. He's not an overly big guy, Brent Severin, but he can handle himself pretty darn well. Boy.
Malpe stuck his nose in towards Rennie Corbet.
Now this came about because of a couple of big hits by Malpe. Biggest guy on the ice is Uwe Krupp. 6'6", 230 pounds plus. He is a giant. And Corbet, who got cranked up by Aaron Ward back in Denver. Look out, here we go. Malpe drops him. And away they go. But the linesmen are right on top of that one early, so it'll be a short one. Short fight and a long rest. Now Draper's getting whistled over by Dvorsky as well.
Lidstrom to McCarty. Here is Larionov. Avalanche holding the Red Wings in their own zone. Larionov and Forsberg away from the play. Peter Forsberg took a swipe at Igor Larionov. And it is an off-in that we see Igor Larionov go, but he did. And now Darren McCarty gets his shots in at Claude Lemieux. And look who came all the way out to try to help. Patrick Roy. My goodness. You never know when to expect it, Darren McCarty said before. Vernon and Waugh. Mike Vernon with a great left. Follows up with the right. How about this? Lemieux was hammered by Darren McCarty, and he is being helped into the locker room. Two of the best of all time, known for the use of the pillows, Vernon and Waugh square off. They are on their feet here at Joe Louis Arena. 301 days since the hit on Chris Draper. And look at Darren McCarty. Patrick Waugh bloodied up. Peter Forsberg bloodied up. And Lemieux in the locker room. Darren McCarty said hockey players have long memories. And the best time to seek, if you will, revenge. To seek redemption is maybe when your opponent least expects it. Say what you will of the situation. Say what you will about the hit. But this is what has happened here tonight. It starts with Forsberg and Igor Larionov. Forsberg with an extra hit to the head. And Igor objects. And he gets the headlock on Peter Forsberg. And then, away from that, Patrick Roy and Mike Vernon. Patrick Roy came out to aid Claude Lemieux. And look at the goalies go. And Patrick Roy has a heck of a size advantage. And Claude Lemieux, he was hammered by Darren McCarty. McCarty came in, and he went after Claude Lemieux. Took the helmet off and got a shot or two in. And that's when Waugh came to Lemieux's rescue. And look at who stepped in on Patrick Waugh. Brendan Shanahan. Welcome back to old-time hockey. Now here's how Darren got loose. And he got the shot in at Claude Lemieux. And from there, pandemonium. Look at the goalies battle. You got to be tough and a little crazy to stop pucks traveling over 100 miles an hour. And they are tough in more ways than one. Mike Vernon and Patrick Waugh.
Look at Osgood smiling in behind Mike Vernon, like trying to hold his smiles back. And I don't think anybody in the building liked what they saw a few minutes ago.
Oh, not anybody.
Boy. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. That is a dandy.
Well, you saw Claude Lemieux come down not that far from our studio, Mick. I don't know if you saw him come through.
No, he may not have been there yet,
but he was bloodied up pretty good.
We're in behind closed doors here on the other side of the Colorado dressing room. But Juan Vernon looked like they're no worse for wear. Patrick got the butterfly over the eye. It looked like Vernie popped him a dandy, although it looked like Juan got a couple in as well. So pretty good exchange by a couple of veteran goaltenders. Very possibly both of them going to the Hall of Fame. Just another day's work at the office.
Patrick Juan, third all-time amongst active goaltenders. And Victor Ace Mick and Mike Vernon right behind him. You know, fourth.
You really do as a professional athlete. You hope nobody gets hurt in these kind of things. It's cleanup time, as you can see right by the Red Wing bench. Several guys had some minor blood dripping from their foreheads, and it didn't look like anybody got seriously injured. But again, hockey players are used to this kind of stuff, and it'll be interesting to see if Scotty Bowman hears what Paul Dvorsky has to say about how he deciphered all of that and who's getting what. And I'm sure the announcements to follow shortly, but they were waiting for it and they got it. Mark Crawford not happy what he saw out there, and it looks like he's complaining that there should have been more. He's not happy with the call by the looks of it from Paul Dvorsky.
Well, McCarty's going to get a double minor for roughing, and that will be the main difference. Colorado is going to have a 4-minute power play. Forsberg and Larionov both go 2 each for roughing. Waugh and Vernon get 2 for roughing and 5 for fighting, respectively. And then Darren McCarty with the extra 4 for roughing. And guess who wasn't even on the ice throughout all of it? Chris Draper. Sat on the bench and watched from a pretty darn close seat to where everything was happening.
Well, a minute and a half to the intermission, they'll be buzzing at the popcorn stand. You can bet on that.
Lidstrom in deep. Now the Red Wings with a different challenge, and that is to kill off some power plays. Now it's going to be Adam Deadmarsh and Konstantinov. You've got the monitor down in front of you, Mick.
I can see this one. Deadmarsh, we talked about him at the top of the show. He's a tough kid, big goal scorer, and he's been after Konstantinov, as many of the Colorado players have, as he likes to give it. So this looks like it may be a long, long night for everybody involved, but most of all, I'm sure the fans having fun. Let's just hope nobody gets seriously hurt. Little fight, few stitches, never hurt anybody. It's a long way from the heart. Jason Hillman just came in. We're next door, as I said, Mike, to the Colorado locker room. And he's got on the note here, Forsberg and Lemieux getting stitches in the locker room right next to us here. So, as I said, another day's work at the office for a hockey player.
And so in 37 seconds, Colorado will have a power play. It will be their third of the night. Right off the start, Shanahan and Adam Foote. Here we go again. That took exactly 4 seconds. Foote tries to get a right uppercut in. Shanahan has him tied up well. Now Shanahan with a couple of rights. Trying to connect from over top. Two strong guys going at it here. Somebody's bloodied up. I don't know who it is. You can see the blood in the back on the ice. Looks like it's Adam Foote. And the referees step in. Right off the opening faceoff here in the second period. Foote obviously a defenseman. But in the four-on-four situation, within reach of Brendan Shanahan. And the penalty boxes getting a bit crowded. With 16 minutes and 30 seconds remaining here in the second period. LaPointe gets his 13th of the season. Kozlov will earn the assist.
There, here goes Keane. Who's that? And Holmstrom.
Holmstrom.
This will be interesting. We haven't seen Holmstrom in a fight this year. He likes to play it physical. Keane's a crusty veteran. And Vernon's overlooking this thing if Keane goes to battling on him. Oh, he does. Vernon's got the gloves off. And the referee's holding him back. Now Ward, he's got loose. Who's he with? Can't see the number. That shirt's going to come off quickly. And Ward better get his off.
That might be Severin.
Very quickly. Well, Severin's got no jersey. Ward can't grab it. He's got to take a whack at that kid and back him off. Now he's got a good hold on him. And that sweater's off. Boy, it's tough. You better have a good fist because there's nothing to grab. And those guys aren't done yet.
Holmstrom and his combatant Mike Keane are both bloodied up.
Look out. Severin's got the left hand loose.
Now if he takes a shot in front of Dvorsky, he's going to be done for the night. Dvorsky, I can read lips. He said, don't.
Severin's frustrated.
Can't blame him, really. I guess once you get in the mood, let's go.
So, the goals are coming a little more freely. The fights continue. What a Donnybrook we've got.
Fedorov is hit by Deadmarsh, and now Murphy gets it. Deadmarsh!
Hang on.
He's going to go with Darren McCarty.
Deadmarsh with a couple of rights in, and now McCarty's got the left loose to try to go with him. He wants that one haymaker. And Deadmarsh trying to get back for what McCarty did to Lemieux. He throws him fast. That's his second fight of the night. And the bell continues to ring. 12:36 to go. 3-2 Colorado, and all night to go. Now more activity. But the extracurriculars here, as they just will not go away. And Big Uwe Krupp, number four, and Pusher, number four, they're going to go. Center ice, and Pusher just continues to go after the veteran big guys. He's got the left hand loose, and here comes Krupp, drilling him back. Oh, man. Krupp is one of the biggest guys in the NHL. And Pusher standing toe-to-toe with him at center ice. Boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. LaPointe away from the fight, talking to Corbet. Got a hold on him, and Pusher and Krupp are separated. They have a pretty good goal. Everybody else seems to be calmed down.
The quote rivalry, only in Detroit's spiteful dreams. Fact is, the Wings can't find a way to beat the Avalanche. With Vanessa Braun, neither exists anymore. And McCarty, one of the many stars.
Third bunch.
How about the two-goal night for Marty LaPointe?
Very, very physical game right from the beginning. And you're going to have a couple of teams that are banged and bruised up after this one. It had a
apropos is this: the two guys who had to fill the big shoes, the void of Dino Ciccarelli back at the beginning of the year, are the stars of one of the Red Wings' biggest wins in this regular season. Darren McCarty, the game-winning goal.
It had it all tonight, boy, that's for sure.